gentlemen, welcome back to the vlog. It's going to be a quick one today, and we are going to be taking a look at a travel that I did last year to a favorite spot of mine, the spot known as Letchworth State Park. So, without further ado, let's get rolling and let's see what interesting new sights and information we have. Now, before we get into the video, I figured I would show you pictures of our little journey to the Genesee River, as we see here. On this day, it was patchy, with sometimes being rainy. But even with the rain, this was probably the lowest we have ever seen the Genesee River. And if you're wondering about a lot of these shots, they may look like they are within the river. Yes, you are absolutely right. They are within the river. Myself and my friend, Michaela, literally walked out through the river, and at some point our boots getting very, very soaking wet. But they dried off pretty quickly. It just goes to show you, remember these words, folks. Do as I say, not as I do. Don't try this at home. Starting today off, myself and Michaela hopped onto trail number 7, as we see on the map here, as it snaked its way along the eastern side of the upper gorge through an area known as the Rock Cut. And it went down through the park towards the Genesee Valley Canal Locks, as you see on the map. Trying to get there was difficult. It was very weeded over, and we had to go down a small service road to the area where you see in the panoramic view. This is where we managed to hop onto the trail as to where it led us to. Going down the trail, we got to see some very interesting sights and views and sounds as we walked along a side of the gorge that not many people often go on. Still, going along this side of the gorge, you can hike for all of the trail and see some of the interesting geologic and geographic sites there. For some parts of it, you can also snowmobile, go on with ATVs, horseback riding, or even skiing. And once you get down, you also get to see these open fields that are just above the upper waterfalls near Portageville. And also you get to see the giant railroad viaduct built by Norfolk Southern above. And getting past this, you get to go see the upper falls themselves. It is a bit of a ways, but if you are up for walking, you'll get to see some very nice views, and if it was like this with the rain, you'll get to see some rainbows. Now, you do also see that the waterfalls were very low this time, because remember what I said, the water was very low in the Genesee River. And, of course, we still got some good views. And do bear in mind that you get to see nature, as Michaela also managed to catch a frog. And also, you can see some very, very interesting tidbits here and there. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're probably wondering why there is a bunch of railroad ties strewn around the area around this trail in the park. Well, this is where the information comes in. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's take a trip back in time. A travel back in time over 150 years ago. And let's take a look and see what the history shows for the past in this area. Looking back above the gorge, back at the Rock Cut, myself and Michaela came across these two stone piers sitting lonely in the river. It was later discovered that there were not just two, but three or four of these piers that were sitting in the Genesee River. I questioned the history of this region for quite some time, and as it had shown on the map, remember what I had said, there were the locks of the Genesee Valley Canal that used to run through the area. What may surprise you is these piers were a part of that canal system. That is correct. These held up an aquifer that carried the canal itself through the gorge. On May 11th, 1836, big news came to the communities of Nunda, Portage, and Genesee Falls. The legislature of New York State had approved a plan to build a canal system to connect the southern tier city of Olean with Rochester. This canal would go all the way up from Olean along the Genesee Valley and down the Genesee River to Rochester. As we see, it crossed over the Genesee River on the old aquifer, and going through the valley, it snaked its way along man-made ledges that were blasted out of the cliff sides in the Portageville Gorge. The rock cut alone took hundreds of Irish workers just to build that. And with the coming of the earlier railroads as well, it too would find its way heading right underneath the railroad viaducts. More on them later. But it would be 20 years before the first canal boat floated down this canal. In those days, canal building was a very difficult, daunting, and dangerous task, especially when trying to go all the way up from the valleys below before reaching the Portage Highlands. Unfortunately, the years of service of this commercial artery were numbered from the start. Due to mounting maintenance costs and growing competition from the ever-expanding railroads of America, the Genesee Valley Canal suffered greatly. And it was finally decided that in 1878, after that season, the canal closed. Over the next 4 years, the canal itself would be filled in, and a set of rails would be placed on top. And in 1882, the Genesee Valley Canal Railway was born. With this, the old aqueduct was mainly dismantled, except for the number of pillars that we had seen that day. These became the abutments for a replacement railroad bridge across the Genesee River. With this new rail passage, trains could now run along the gorge from Olean all the way to Rochester. They'd be able to see plenty of sights and hear plenty of sounds as they came through such a picturesque landscape. However, this was not without its mishaps, the most common ones being the upsetting of the water table within the cliffs, especially when rainwater caused the water table to swell, which caused maintenance issues. On top of this, there were frequent rock slides in the gorge, some of them very nasty and causing trains to fall into the river. The final straw, as I had heard from a friend of one of the engineers on the Pennsylvania Railroad, was a rock slide in the 1950s that caused his friend's locomotive to derail into the gorge, eventually killing his friend. As a result, the days were numbered for the rails, and in 1963, the final train of the Pennsylvania Railroad, successor in this area of the Genesee Valley Canal Railway, went through the gorge for the last time. This ended the story of the rails. heading back to the other side of the gorge, we made a stop at probably the most famous building in Letchworth State Park, the Glen Iris Inn, the once glamorous home to Mr. William Pryor Letchworth, co-founder of the Pratt and Letchworth Company in Buffalo, New York. Inside, we managed to see some models, one being of the first ever railroad bridge that was built through the across the gorge in the 19th century. This bridge, built by the Buffalo and New York City Railroad, was commissioned in 1852. At the time, it was the largest timber bridge ever built in the world. This bridge, which had most of its foundation built out of the local timber, could carry trains across the gorge at a height of more than 300 feet. And as you will also know, it was the first bridge that the old canal boats on the Genesee Valley Canal went under. And a very interesting thing that occurred was, during the American Civil War, the Union Army even placed sentries and infantry at both ends of the bridge and had an active watch on it to avoid sabotage. Not very many places in New York State had such an importance as it did for this. And as you'll also notice from some of these pictures, in Victorian times, people were actually allowed to actually go out and walk on the bridge itself. Talk about leniency from yesteryear. And by seeing the pictures, you can also see just how intricate this bridge was. If you imagine how bridges are built nowadays, think about the skill you needed in the past for such projects. Sadly, disaster would strike the bridge at about 1 o'clock in the morning on May 6, 1875, when a watchman at the bridge noticed a fire had broken out on it. Attempting to stifle the flames failed, and eventually the whole bridge, by the morning, would come crashing down into the gorge, ending this wooden bridge saga. But one interesting bit we have is from William Pryor Letchworth himself, who was awoken by the flames. Every timber in the bridge seemed then to be ignited, and an open network of fire was stretched across the upper end of the valley. Above the bridge, and touching its upper line, a black curtain hung down from the sky, its lower edge belted with a murky fringe of fire. The hoarse growl of the flames and crackling of the timbers sounded like a hurricane approaching through the forest. The water in the river was glistening with the bright flare thrown upon it, and the whole valley of the Glen Iris was illuminated in tragic splendor. As 15 minutes passed four, the superstructure of the west end of the bridge sank downward, and the depression rolled throughout its length to the east end like the sinking of an ocean wave. The whole upper superstructure, including the heavy T-rails, went down with a crashing sound so terrible as it came to our ears on the wind that it surpassed the roar of the falling avalanches. Timber, rails, bolts, abrading and dislodging burning coals as they fell, crashed downward into indistinguishable ruin. Of course, this being the golden age of rail, a solution was quickly found for a replacement for the old Buffalo and New York City Bridge. An engineer for the Erie Railroad came up with the idea to reuse the old stone abutments sitting at the bottom of the gorge as the foundation for a new steel bridge. This bridge would eventually be completed in July of 1875, as seen in this picture here. Work that took less than 3 months to do. As you can imagine, this was 1875. This was still Victorian times. And as you can imagine, that is quite a monumental feat to be accomplished during such primitive times. The bridge would be a vital asset for well over a century, almost a century and a half, going through many railroads from the Erie to the Erie Lackawanna to Conrail to Norfolk Southern, being the most recent. Unfortunately, as years went on, the bridge would lose a lot of its integrity. And as a result, due to frequent failing of inspections by the railroad and by New York State, the conclusion was drawn for a replacement bridge. And starting in 2016-2017, the plan was to build a new bridge 75 feet to the south, and in 2018, the old bridge would finally be taken down, the blasting charges knocking the whole thing into the river, and saying a fine farewell to the golden days of railroading. The last pieces of this bridge being this girder sitting where the old bridge used to be. And another piece now in the collection of the Western New York Railway Historical Society. And here is the specimen that we see before us. The third bridge across the Letchworth Gorge. A bridge that is an architectural specimen that sums up the past 151 years of railroading through the gorge of the Genesee Valley. If you are wondering why this is so different, it's because the tracks on either sides of the gorge were now given less tight curves, and as a result, longer, heavier trains are now able to go across the bridge at 3 times the original speed, that being 10 miles per hour, the original, and now up to 30 miles per hour. If you do wish to see more images and or videos of my reactions to this bridge and the trains going across it, you can feel free to check out the links in the video description box below, where you will see my first view of the bridge back in 2018 from the 2018 pre-cruise vlog, and you will also see the shots from 2020 when I went to Letchworth State Park to see the trains that went by and managed to catch some incredible and rather surprising runs that went through the gorge. So, this is what we have with the lesson today, folks, and I hope you did enjoy. Remember, stop, look, and listen, and be careful around the rails. So, ladies and gentlemen, that wraps up the 350-day mark towards the next cruise. We will be seeing each other again in 50 days, and let me know in the comments section down below. If you do want to see more videos like this, I'm willing to do them for you guys. I just need to hear your guys' thoughts, feelings, and, well, I guess not actions in this point. But I hope you guys enjoyed this one, and I hope it brings light to you some of the history that comes from this area. And if you do get a chance to go to Letchworth State Park, I can assure you, you will not be disappointed. So, ladies and gentlemen, I shall see you in the next one in 50 days' time. I am the Tank Commander. Out.